Notice of a public meeting of the City Commission of the City of Brownsville. Pursuant to Chapter 551, Title 5 of the Texas Government Code, the Texas Open Meetings Act, notice is hereby given at the City Commission of the City of Brownsville, Texas, in accordance with Article 5, Section 12 of the Charter of said city, will convene an executive session, a workshop, and a regular meeting on Tuesday, March the 18th, 2014, at 5:35 p.m., 5:45 p.m., and 6 p.m. in the Commission Chambers on the second floor of Brownsville City Hall, located at 1001 East Elizabeth Street, Brownsville, Cameron County, Texas. Workshop Item A, presentation regarding Bike Brownsville Initiative.
Mayor, City Commission, this is kind of an informational update on our efforts in bicycling through the city. We've had a lot of work, we've done a lot of work in the past year, and we kind of wanted to update you as to what we've done and where we're going and what our strategy is with these efforts. So our current efforts, our traffic department has done a great job of putting that down, a lot of bike lanes and signage across the city, trying to make the city safer. We're trying to improve our Battlefield Trail. Metro Connect is also a service where we want to connect through bus, we want to connect the valley, so people could get on a bike, get on the bus, go to McAllen, get on a bike over there, come back. So that's an effort that bus is also underway. The Belden Trail has been completed in West Brownsville, and that's a great addition to the West Brownsville neighborhood. But we are working on some additional trails in other parts of town, at District 2 with Commissioner Chavez, and Southmost Trail in District 1 with Commissioner Longoria along the drainage canal. So we have a lot of efforts going on. We've also done a lot of policy amendments. This commission passed the Complete Streets Initiative. We passed a safe passage ordinance. We passed a sidewalk amendment to improve pedestrian conditions. We passed a bike parking ordinance to require bike parking and development. We undertook a hike and bike master plan, and we adopted the master plan. The MPO has also adopted our master plan, or is in the process. And the library has helped us out with some public service announcements and trying to once again improve the safety and educate the citizens on biking and pedestrian. So we have a lot of partners. One of the main partners is sitting behind me, Fernando, with Bike Texas. He's been critical to this effort and getting everybody together. But there's also a list: Healthy Communities, BC Workshop, CDCB, BCIC, the District, TxDOT, United Brownsville, Leadership Brownsville. Recently, at this last Ciclovia, I was volunteering for the Bike Barn, and all these entities. We've discovered we have a lot of bike clubs in Brownsville. We have four main bike clubs in Brownsville, and we want to continue promoting our relationship with them. We used to have one bike shop. Now we have, I believe, three in different areas of town. So obviously, this is something that shows that business is there for cycling. And as you well know, we have a lot of programs: Ciclovia, bike rodeos, the Brownsville Bike Barn, Pedal de Padre, Bikes to the Beach. These are all either efforts that are ongoing, that have been going on for 20 years, or new efforts that are in its infancy. We have group rides, Historic Brownsville Bicycle Tour. These are all organized privately by citizens. 7 and 7 on Wednesdays, JT Cycling Bike Rides, Velociraptors, the Brownsville Biker Grade. I think they go out at night on Thursdays. And Critical Mass is the same thing. So who's doing the work? Once again, all the partners that I showed you earlier, and the city as well. So where do we want to go, I think, is the biggest the question that we wanted to, or where we what we wanted to show you today. Well, we want to partner up with national organizations. We want additional funding. We want to leverage the funding throughout the country. We want to implement a cycle track network. That means that there's dedicated lanes in Brownsville, on street but separated from traffic. We want to improve state routes to school so that kids can bike and walk to school. And we want to make Brownsville the bike capital of Texas or the bike capital of the Rio Grande Valley. I think we want to shoot for Texas. We also want to get bicycle-friendly status. That's very important to most communities that have an effort like this. And once again, safety and education is paramount to any bicycling effort. So you can see that you can't really see it really well, but these are different types of facilities that you can. This is a green lane down here, and just once again, protecting the rider and making it promoting. So the bicycling capital of Texas, that's something to shoot for. You know, where we all go and travel, I see a lot of bicycle tourism everywhere. Everywhere I go, I think I get on a bike now. There's a lot of bike share programs that different cities in Texas and around the world are doing. Texas, the latest one is Austin, but Austin, San Antonio, Houston, and Dallas have implemented or are implementing bike share. We obviously want to build our trail network, and we're doing that. We're working on those projects, and we want a bicycle network. National partnerships, there's all different kinds of organizations that you can partner with to once again leverage funding and gain support for Brownsville amongst these other cities. So what are the next steps? So we have Bike Texas, and a lot of cities have moved towards creating their own identity. And we believe that where we need to go to is Bike Brownsville. Bike Brownsville, Bike Austin, Bike Houston, Bike Dallas, they've all done their own organizations. And so we created this kind of this working logo that says Bike Brownsville. What's the vision of this organization? It envisions a community that cycles, an inclusive, diverse, and accepting community where people of all ages and backgrounds bicycle to work and get around for health and fun. Basically everything that we've been saying in our plans and what we've been communicating. So the mission is to advance the movement to make Brownsville a bicycle-friendly community. Our commitment is to listen and learn, define standards, and transform Brownsville streets and neighborhoods into more livable and safe places by promoting bicycle for everyday transportation. So this would really be about an advocacy organization. It would be a nonprofit status. There could be a 501c3, it would be a volunteer board. And obviously this is just a draft, this is just kind of a vision, but this is where we want to move towards. And once again, this could, it would be a local advocacy group that could take on the organization of events and these bike rides and all that. So that would kind of alleviate the city's responsibility for organizing these events. The end goal would be to make it a sustainable organization by itself, either through memberships or grants or other funding sources. And these are some of the ways that you do. You either sell merchandise or sell memberships, or you organize events. And I mean, just what a typical organization does. This is a nice chart that says, what the benefits of cycling and health and we could provide that for you at a later date. One of the things that this organization will do is event support or event continuation. For example, we've heard that River Rockets is no longer going to organize Pedal to Padre. So right now, there's two volunteer people that are organizing that event of 1,000 riders or more. So they definitely need support. So we envision that this organization could provide that support. We could host family cycling workshops. And once again, it's an advocacy group. So we wanted to show a couple of pictures of some things that we see that we've seen in Brownsville. For example, this picture, you could see the grass is trampled. So you can see that, someone's actually using it as a sidewalk. So we probably need a sidewalk there, right? Or in this picture, this is on 802. The bike lane just kind of ends. It doesn't, so that could create a different issue. So, and here, one of the most important things that we've discovered with Fernando's help is We don't really do a good job of advertising our hike and bike trail. Like you see here, we kind of point people at Texas Parks and Wildlife, but we have no signage on the trail. This is the trail intersection. So advocacy is probably the most important mission. And this is Brownsville's future. So, you know, we have kids out on bikes and enjoying the day, much like on Sunday. So we just wanted to inform you on these efforts. If you have any questions, concerns, you know, feel free to ask. It's a workshop.
Well, great job. I mean, I think this is something that a lot of our community is looking forward to. I know that I am. I try and be an avid bike rider, but that doesn't always work out. But great job, and we're looking forward to see what progress is made with this.
Yeah, Ramiro, I think it's a great job. What is the next step? I mean, in other words, where are we going to and what are we going to do? Are we going to be looking at a nonprofit organization? How do we proceed? I'm just trying to get some direction from you. What do you see as the next step?
The next step would be to take Bike Brownsville and incorporate it, make it a nonprofit, work for its nonprofit status, create a board. That will run these events, and you know, and kind of, once again, I think it's to alleviate the city's responsibility on organizing these events. I think is a big goal that we should have. So it's in its infancy, right? So I think it's good that, you know, the city could provide its support, and it doesn't necessarily have to be financial support, but it could provide its support by its grant writers or planning staff, or just, you know, here and there, just scraping what we can, until it takes on its own, and it goes out and gets grants and, you know, kind of scrounges around for grants. So I think that's the next step, to incorporate this organization and move forward.
Okay, is that what they've done in Austin and the other places you mentioned?
That's what they've done in Austin and Houston as well.
For example, in San Antonio, they started Ciclovia, and then they passed it to the YMCA, which is already not-for-profit status. So now the Y runs those initiatives. City does participate, but they're not the ones that are going out and getting the funding and the you know, all the stuff that it involves. They're just a smaller partner. So there are other cities that are doing similar things to be able to grow the organization and make it more sustainable.
A perfect example is the Charo Day festivities here. You know, there's all these nonprofits that handle all the events. You know, the city just kind of provides backup support. So that's where we envision this.
Okay, very good. Any other questions? Okay, thank you, Ramiro.
Thank you.
I think we're ready for executive session.
Executive session, item A, consultation with attorney pursuant to section 551.071 parentheses 2 of the Texas Government Code on a matter in which the duty of the attorney to the governmental body under the Texas Disciplinary Rules of Professional Conduct of the State Bar of Texas clearly conflicts with the duties under Chapter 551 of the Texas Government Code and 551.072 of the Texas Government Code to deliberate the purchase, sale, and exchange and lease or value of real property.
Here, I move we go into executive session.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
For the Pledge of Allegiance and the invocation.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands,
one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Honor the Texas flag. I pledge allegiance to thee, Texas, one state under God, one and indivisible.
The invocation will be given by Pastor Lance Hostetter.
Will you join me in prayer? Lord, we thank you for this beautiful day, and we just pray your blessing upon these proceedings. We pray for each one involved today. We pray for our local, state, and federal governments, and we pray for the people of the Ukraine at this time. Lord, I ask a prayer now for all those in our nursing homes, all those that are sick and that have lost loved ones, and we pray these things all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Action on item discussed in executive session. Consideration and action on items discussed in executive session pertaining to the purchase, sale, exchange, lease, or value of property.
Mr. Mayor, I'd like to motion to purchase the property at 1355 East Madison for $155,000, payable without interest over 62 months, in order to establish parking for the Cueto building, and terminate the existing lease for the same property for the amount of $35,000, payable over 14 months without interest.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Motion carries. Thank you.
Mayor's report.
Yes, if I'm permitted, I'd like to take this opportunity to announce two or three different things. The last time we were here, we talked about the Affordable Care Act and the fact that there was going to be registration at the Valley Baptist Hospital, at the Brownsville Community Clinic, and Suclinica. We noted today, and I have two representatives here, Jose and Danielle, that I want them to say hello. Local people enrolling. Danielle is actually from Washington, D.C., down here on a special assignment. There's been over 5 million people that have now enrolled in the Affordable Care Act. Regardless of your views, it is the law. We have 13 days left. We will not have another city meeting before that takes place. I can tell you from personal experience that in my case with my staff, that the pre-existing condition exemption, which allows all of my employees to be able to sign up, and the other part that probably is worrisome to some folks is sometimes when you have a catastrophic event that occurs in your family, you incur these exorbitant bills, and if you're not able to pay them, then you can never go back and get any health care. So that is also obviated by virtue of this Affordable Care Act, and it's based upon your earnings. So I think everybody should at least attempt to go take a look at it, see if it fits your needs. We want to make sure that everybody knows that you've got 13 days left. If you don't sign up before March the 31st, then you won't have an opportunity to do so until it starts again for next year, which will be November 1st again. So those two folks that I mentioned to you, they're here for any questions you might have. They'll also be open. We're opening up the pavilion at the Dean Porter Park. Is that correct, guys? On Saturday, urge your friends, family, at least go find out what it's all about. Find out if it's something that's good for you, and chances are that it probably will be. But for some people, it's just, you know, they say, well, I just can't afford it. Well, some people don't have to pay anything, actually. So please make it a point. It's good for you, it's good for your kids, it's good for your spouses, it's good for your family. I wanted just to shout out a wonderful thanks to all the city employees. Fernando Luis took pictures, Commissioner Rose, for the wonderful work that everybody did on the Ciclovia on Sunday. We actually had a great crowd and a wonderful crowd. And then the last, and this is not a, it's just I was notified, for some of you who have been here in Brownsville for a long time, like I have, a lot of us have eaten a lot of pizza at Gio's. Miss Rose Jordan passed away this morning. So I just wanted to, you know, give my condolences to the Jordan family. She was, you know, a lot of us spent a lot of time there. So, and that's the mayor's activity report.
I'd like to thank, echo what you said and thank city staff, specifically the health department, the traffic department, police department, for all your hard work for another very successful Ciclovia. Thousands of people were out there enjoying the streets, including our congressman. School of Public Health has been a strong partner in this effort, and of course our title sponsor HEB and many, many other sponsors, including the Reclavia sponsors of BISD, Community Development Corporation, and the UT Department of Health and Human Performance. So thank you again. Stay in touch for the next Ciclovia coming up in June. We will have four this year. The next two will be at nighttime on Friday nights, and the final one in December will be on a Sunday afternoon again.
Thank you, Commissioner.
I have two announcements. One is I had the opportunity to meet the local home for outcry in the barrio, and I would encourage any of the commissioners, if you get a chance, go stop by. It's a new ministry that has been, it's not that old in our city, but they came out and I was able to go visit them and talk with them and sit down and with regards to the services that they render for our community. So they're a nonprofit organization that offers residential services to addicts and homeless adults in our community, and they're reaching out to the community if any of us want to go visit them and see what other services they provide. And if any of you know of anybody that needs their services, they help with drug addiction and homelessness in our city. So I want to give them thanks for the services that they render to our community. I also wanted to thank the First Family Network of Cameron County for their support and their sponsorship in the Brownsville Reads campaign. They signed up, so they will be hosting one of our Brownsville Reads displays to be placed in the Cameron County Courthouse. The other providers that have come on board, as of right now, we have Vision Eye Care Clinic as well, and we want to thank them, both of them, for sponsoring one of our reading kiosks. And if anybody knows of anybody that's interested in sponsoring one of our kiosks, you can go ahead and contact city staff or myself for any further information regarding the Brownsville Reads project.
I just wanted to mention that one of my constituents, who's a really cool constituent, just published a book. It's called Never Enough Time. She's a Brownsville resident, Brownsville homegrown, so we're extra proud of her. It's available on barnesandnobles.com, amazon.com. It's called Never Enough Time. It's a really cool book because it is factually correct, based in Brownsville in the 1800s, I believe. And it's all factually correct. It talks about all the buildings and streets and everything, and it's a really cool story, so I recommend that you download it, buy it, whatnot. I also wanted to mention that we're having this year, Mr. Kabler was awesome enough to work with us to have an Easter party at Portway Acres Park. And so this is the first time we ever have an Easter egg hunt and Easter party there at Portway Acres. It's the park that we remodeled. We did a splash pad, walking trail, all sorts of stuff. So we're having an Easter party, and if anybody is interested in sponsoring, even the smallest of sponsorship, Easter eggs, Easter baskets, anything, candy, you can contact our Parks Department. We would be more than grateful for your help to make this extra special to the neighborhood and area, because it's the first time we ever do this, and so I'm hoping for a really cool turnout. So if you could help us with that, I'd be very grateful.
I also have a report, Mayor. I'd like to talk about a couple weeks back, I was asked to speak at UTB for part of Women's Month, National Women's Month. A group of young ladies were gathered together, part of the UTB Alumni Affairs Outreach, and they're aspiring elected officials. So they want to serve the community, and they had a lot of questions to ask me about the entire political process, what it's like to be in office, to serve the community. And it was very overwhelming to have these young minds ask questions that you didn't even think about before. And it was nice to have a retrospective of the entire process and how people perceive this office from the other side. So I just wanted to congratulate these young ladies ranging from ages 18 to 25 that give us a lot of hope for our community. And so I want to applaud their efforts. And also, something that I and everyone should be very proud of, Brownsville was named 2014 16th best city in the entire United States to start a business. So out of all of the states all of the cities and states were 16th of all the cities, and no other valley city was mentioned on this report, which is amazing. We'll have that listed on our website so that you all may view it, and it's listed on wallethub.com if you're interested and you want to read up on what other cities are on there.
Thank you, Commissioner. Appreciate it.
If I may? I just have a quick note. If you keep up with our meetings, you'll know that about two meetings ago, we presented the United Way's VITA program with a proclamation. They also provided us with a workshop. VITA is their voluntary income tax program. And just an update on their performance, we give them a $25,000 contribution, and in return, I guess you can say a return on our investment. As of the third of this month, they have helped lower income families receive $8,454,410 in their income tax returns. And these are all volunteers that take the time to be trained and certified, and then still, after all that training, still volunteer their free time to help these families fill out their tax returns. Now that number is pretty impressive on its own, and there's still 6 weeks left in the tax season, so I just wanted to thank the good people over there at VITA. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner. Appreciate it. That's all good stuff. Proclamations?
Proclamations, honorary point in time survey volunteers.
She's going to read the proclamation. Y'all kind of lined up there.
Okay. A proclamation of the City Commission of Brownsville, Texas, recognizing all honorary point-in-time survey volunteers. Whereas the economic uncertainty of our present time has brought more of our citizens to bear the problems of homelessness, and whereas the fiduciary and compulsory vein for our neighbors remains for us to lighten the plight of our fellow man. And whereas we salute those who endeavor to better the circumstance of our brothers and sisters' misfortunes. And whereas the City of Brownsville wishes to extend its hands in an embrace to those who willfully participated in the Point in Time Survey 2014 as a much admired carriage for those less fortunate. And whereas data collected during the 2014 point in time count is critical to effective planning and performance management toward the goal of ending homelessness for each community and for the nation as a whole. Now, therefore, we, the members of the City Commission of the City of Brownsville, Texas, by virtue of the authority vested by the charter of said city, and on behalf of all our citizens, do hereby recognize all the honorary point in time survey volunteers of January 23rd, 2014, and further thank them for their outstanding effort. Done on this 18th day of March 2014, Antonio Martinez, Mayor, and City Commissioners. Thank you.
Hello. My name is Julia Lash, and I work with the Office of Grant Management and Community Development. And I just want to thank the volunteers. They were not all able to attend due to their busy schedules, but we had over 30 volunteers that attended this event. And it's a 24-hour event, so I greatly appreciate all the assistance that they provided and the time and the effort that they put into this this event. And I want to thank Commissioners Portillo and Gavin for sponsoring our proclamation.
Well,
thank you.
Thank you all for everything. Appreciate it very much.
Presentations, bike rack design competition results.
Mayor, City Commission, I just want to take a couple of minutes. A couple of months ago, we had the idea of doing a bike rack design contest. We partnered up with the Museum of Fine Arts, and they put together a panel of artists to judge the submittals. We had about 60 submittals, and we had a best in show, a best representative of Brownsville, and a People's Choice. People's Choice was selected over Facebook. We have a Planning Brownsville page, and was kind of tagged throughout the Facebook world. So we want to recognize the winners. The first one is Best in Show, and if the winners are here, I believe there are two here. The Best in Show was Maria Ruiz. She's a university student. She actually submitted two designs, but her Aztec dog was submitted. So if they're here, if they want to say a couple of words, I invite them up.
Hello. I want to thank everybody here for giving me the opportunity to do this design, and not only that, it's great that what Brownsville is doing right now is, how can we say it, they're getting more diverse, they're opening up to the fine arts, and that's a wonderful thing, and I hope you can continue that.
Thank you. Thank you. Great stuff.
The People's Choice, I think there was about 300 or 400 votes for this one. And it says, I think you can barely make it out, but it's Reed, and it's a bike rack. And this was done by Jaime Solis, who is also here. Let me say he's a teacher at Vermilion, so I think that was the inspiration. But
I went to Vermilion.
Good afternoon. Coming as a teacher, I think we need to focus a lot more into the reading part. I think it levels the learning gap, and you know, it provides a way for everybody to link together and be able to come together as a community. So that was my design. As a teacher, you know, I see kids struggle, but throughout the year, it's wonderful to see them progress. And that was my design and my inspiration.
It's great, thank great,
you.
Great.
Thank you.
And coming off of Charo Days, this was the best representative of Brownsville. As you can see, it's a charro with a lariat, and then he's lassoing the bike. So we thought it was really creative. Jose Solis, is he here as well? Okay, he's here as well.
Hey, how are you doing, guys? The inspiration is Larry Spin on the Schwinn, and of course, you know, good old Brownsville. Our roots are right here, and we are really honored and blessed to have Charro Days, right? One of the only holidays in the whole wide world that has a international celebration, and that's why this came about. And of course, I'm always norteño, you know, style in my music, so I play a little bit of accordion, and I ride my bike too. I'm a modern charro, kind of. And, you know, hopefully people appreciate it, you know, and feel more secure, you know, putting their bikes in these racks that took a lot of inspiration and a lot of hard work to design. And it's the glory to God more than anything for having us here and showcasing our talent for everybody to admire and use for their bikes.
Great, thank great, you. Great, thank words, you. Great words.
Good.
So we just wanted to recognize them, and we're also looking at a way to how do we fabricate these. So we'll provide a further report later on.
Very good,
thank you.
Thank you.
Consent agenda items A through D.
Approve.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Motion carries.
Item 6, consideration and action to appoint members to the Charter Review Committee.
Oh, that was.
I think it was to
Commissioner, we don't have any applicants, and I know that some of the commissioners have been interested in activating this board. So really, the agenda item would be to
activate the board.
Activate and let's initiate the process of getting interested people to apply.
That's correct.
And so we'll welcome all applications and present it to you at the next meeting.
And we will be posting it on our city webpage,
yes.
Correct?
Do we need a motion to activate the committee? Yeah.
Yes, motion to activate the committee.
All those in favor say aye.
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 Any nays? Motion carries.
Item 7, consideration and action to appoint one member to the Brownsville Citizens Advisory Committee.
Mayor, commissioners, good evening. If you take a look, this is actually a revised version of what was in the Friday's packet. There were some corrections that needed to be made in regards to eligibility of some of these applicants. But we did get three applications in. Our committee is made up as composed of 11 members. We've had one vacancy for quite some time. It's been a bit challenging to fill that last spot. But thankfully we did get some applications in. We start our funding evaluation tomorrow, so it'd be great if we could get that last vacancy filled. And so we have here, the only applicant who's eligible is Martin Sarkis, which is we strongly recommend, because according to our ordinance and according to HUD regulations, we have to have one third of our committee be of low income or have a business in a low income area, and Mr. Sarkis satisfies that, so we strongly recommend that he be appointed to the committee.
And Mr. Garcia did not qualify?
Mr. Garcia did not qualify. He sat on the committee in the past, and you know his term is what makes him ineligible. He will be eligible in a couple of months.
I thought that time had already elapsed and that he had already.
We double checked today, and both he and Carlos Garcia are a couple months short of being eligible.
I'd like to nominate Martin Sarkis.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
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 Motion carries.
Thank you.
Item 8. Second public hearing for the proposed first substantial amendment to the fiscal year 2013-2014 HUD Community Development Block Grant CDBG program funding allocation.
I want to introduce our social service coordinator. Her name is Julia Denise Lash. So she deals with all of our social service agencies. She also for both CDBG and ESG. So she'll be presenting tonight.
Good evening. Tonight we're having the second public hearing for a substantial amendment that is necessary for this current fiscal year for our CDBG funding. The substantial amendments are required when there's a change of $50,000 or more, or when there's an elimination or an addition of an agency. If we can go to the next slide. Our proposed changes are elimination of the Girl Scouts of the Lower Rio Grande Valley and elimination of Dentists Who Care. Both of these agencies declined their award due to capacity. And so we are proposing to add the Brownsville Adult Literacy Program or Center to receive $15,000 in funding, which is what they requested. They were initially, when we submitted the one-year action plan and it was approved, we had an alternate list, and they are the first agency on that alternate list. So if we can go to the next slide. This is a little table or an outline of what the proposed changes are. The elimination of the Girl Scouts, we had originally awarded them $10,000. The Dentists Who Care agency had only received partial funding of $11,000. So what we're proposing is to give the $15,000 to the Brownsville Adult Literacy, which they had asked for initially on their application, and sending the $6,000 remaining to the uncommitted funds for our CDBG programs.
How many organizations were on the backup list?
On the alternative list, I have it right here. There was three agencies, ma'am.
How did we select the Brownsville Literacy to be the only recipient?
It was the first alternate on that list.
But there's still funds left over, correct?
We have $6,000 left over, and we are proposing to submit that to the uncommitted funds.
So why wouldn't we allocate it to one of those other groups?
We have a
We have a threshold requirement of $10,000.
Oh.
And given
because it's only 6,000.
It's only 6,000. It's the capacity on both ends for the agency and for ourselves. It's just a lot of paperwork for $6,000. So we had put that threshold in place a while back.
I'm just curious, what were the other agencies that were on that alternate list?
It is Amigos del Valle and Catholic Charities.
But we're giving the literacy program 15, so if we reduce it to the 10, wouldn't that give us 10 and 10?
We would, but what we had approved early on before the funding cycle was that, you know, the next request in line, we would fully fund them. If they still had the capacity to carry that out. So it was only fair to fund them what they actually requested initially, which was the full
$15,000. Okay.
I will mention, though, just based on your expressions, that as we continue on for the next couple of months, if we see that some of the agencies are struggling to spend some of their funds, or towards the very end, we see there's funds available, we will reallocate those funds to the next in line as well. So there's still an opportunity for those.
Okay.
And that's what the $6,000 that we have pending that we're going to send to uncommitted funding, it's for that purpose as well. If another agency is in need of additional funding, we can also allocate it to them. Or if we need to allocate it to a new agency, we can do that as well. I believe this year was the first year that we actually have an alternate list, which is really helping us in managing these funds.
Yeah, it's just, it's hard to see agencies not getting money when there's, so it hurts me.
Yes, it is. So to summarize all this, this is the proposed changes for this current fiscal year. This is the second public hearing, and it is our first substantial amendment submitted to HUD. The comment period ended on March 11th, which was last week, and we will be submitting this substantial amendment to HUD tomorrow.
We need a motion. Hearing. It was a public hearing.
Motion closed.
It's a public
second.
Hearing.
Second.
Yeah, I think you have we have a public hearing. Is anybody, any comments?
I think it's
motion to close. Second. Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
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 Motion carries. Thank you very much.
Nice. Thank you.
Item 9, public hearing in action on first reading of ordinance number 2014-736-0-0, to increase parking meter rates in the downtown area by repealing and replacing Chapter 98, Traffic and Vehicles, Article 5, Stopping, Standing, and Parking, Division 6, Parking Meters, Sections 98-361 to 98-381, adding Section 98-382 with Sections 98-383 through 98-410 to be reserved and dealing with related matters.
Mayor, City Commission, this item was tabled at a second reading, the first meeting in January, and it was requested that we host a town hall. We did that. I believe three or four commissioners at separate times came in and observed the comments from the crowd. I put together a reduced presentation just to kind of summarize what it is that we're presenting in front of you tonight. So why do we even have parking meters, right? Parking meters are used to encourage turnover of convenient short-term parking spaces in high-demand areas and to obtain an economic return on the use of the city streets and public parking lots. So it's really meant to control and to try to have parking availability in the area. And this is straight out of a 1986 study that was done here in Brownsville. Why are we proposing the hike to increase available parking? One of the main complaints that we have that I've heard is that there is no parking downtown. So that's one of the reasons. Reduce cruising and traffic congestion. If you can't find a parking spot, you usually find yourself kind of going around the curb, going around the block. We'd really like for those people to find parking, conveniently park, and spend money in downtown instead of looking for parking. So with that, you encourage commercial activity and vibrancy, and then to create revenue that can fund public improvements of downtown. So this is one of the main problems. I believe this was 9:30 on 9:30 in the morning on Elizabeth. So you can see there's no parking. This is another sometimes customers will actually, and I've you know, it's been one of my, a lot of people have told me, you know, if I can't find parking, I'll just leave. So these are a couple of pictures. You can see the traffic's being stacked up, people cruising for a parking lot, parking spot. Problem three, there's also no permanent downtown improvement fund that would allow us to invest in downtown and give us that steady source of revenue over the long term to develop projects and invest in them. And these are some ideas, throughout the country. So this is, the research shows that, if parking is too cheap, then there is a lot of abuse in the system. There's a lot of inefficiencies in the system. So it doesn't attract vibrancy and commercial activity. So the last parking meter rate increase was in 1976. And 10 years later, there was a study done that was never implemented. And these are some of the quotes that are there. An adequate supply of public parking that is well managed, efficiently operated, and properly maintained is important to the future growth of Brownsville, of downtown Brownsville. And the following recommended changes will improve the capability for providing short-term parking. One of those changes was to do 60 cents an hour, to go from 20 cents at the time to 60 cents. What do the experts say? We've had a variety of experts come to Brownsville over the past 2-3 years, planners and architects and leaders in their field. And this is Jeff Speck. This is he provided a report for Brownsville. And he said, once again, it's too cheap. We need to do something about it. And we need to invest the money that the city makes back into the downtown area. Same thing with Dan Burden. Create a business improvement district, a parking benefit district. That's in essence what we're creating with this ordinance. And the 2011 study by a firm in Austin said the same thing. So identifying the right price, the price that achieves an 85% occupancy rate is not a free market. It is a public price where a public service should be set to achieve the public goal of improving transportation, land use, and the environment. So the recommendation in 1986 was 60 cents. Other cities, this is what other cities are at, including border cities. And I went back and looked at, price comparisons from 1986 to 2013. And as you can see, gas, everything's gone up. And gas was 93 cents. Movie ticket was 275. I don't remember. I think the cheapest for me was $3.25. Everything has increased in price. These are the facts of the ordinance. The hourly rate, this is the new proposal. The hourly rate now is, what we're proposing in front of you, is 60 cents or 20 cents every 20 minutes. Establishes a downtown employee and owner parking pass at $30, $30 a month or $1 a day, which is cheaper than what it is today. Right now, if you park on the curb and you feed the meter, it's $2. We are making one change. Right now, we accept nickels, dimes, and quarters, and this would be dimes and quarters. This ordinance also authorizes another increase in 3 years to 75 cents. Initially, we had proposed an increase in fines. We've taken that out. And it establishes a downtown fund. And this is the comparison between both. So what's in it for business owners? They're paying less than what they pay today on the curb. There's available parking for their customers. And there'll be additional vibrancy and sales. That's what the research shows. There's a downtown revitalization fund that will allow us to invest in different programs and different projects that will attract more activity. And this is a case of Old Pasadena. Some people say, well, it doesn't work. But Old Pasadena, and I'll just read, Old Pasadena had no parking meters and no on-street parking was restricted because parking was free. Customers had difficulty finding places to park in part because store employees use the on-store parking, moving spots every 2 hours to avoid fines. So Old Pasadena today is very vibrant. It's the case that everybody wants to be. What happened there, they started charging what the market held. The meter revenue was invested in the downtown area, and there you could see the results. So this is the summary. Will it ultimately boost downtown and attract more customers to the area? By creating parking mobility, reducing traffic congestion, and creating a fund to dedicate investment. So if you have any questions.
I have a quick question. On the slideshow that you had parking rates for Laredo, San Antonio, Houston. I don't really remember because I don't have a copy of it, but I know that it was nothing within the valley. Do you know what the rates within the valley are?
I believe McAllen is at 75 cents as well.
How about Harlingen?
I do not. I didn't investigate Harlingen.
Would you check, like?
I believe it's also 50 to 75 cents Harlingen. That's the, I mean, the average rate
but
across the state, but I didn't look at Harlingen.
Okay.
Ramiro, I'm sorry.
No. Mr. Pena, do you know what the rate is downtown in Harlingen? There's no parking on Jackson. There's no
meters.
No meters.
Sorry.
With the current rate, how much do we have to subsidize out of the general fund just to pay for the employees? And
I believe the general fund subsidizes about $20,000 to $30,000, give or take, year, depending on the years, right?
So in other words, people that don't come downtown are being taxed those $20,000 or $30,000. And with the increase, only people that use the service would be paying for it.
You could look at it that way. The general fund is not paying for the current operations. The general fund ends up subsidizing the current operations,
which is everyone's tax.
Exactly,
money.
Exactly. So this would go way beyond. The revenue would definitely pay for the operations. And what we're saying is the increase in revenue above the operational costs would be dedicated to downtown. So,
okay.
I had asked you, we had a conversation about the employees that work downtown. I know that when we had our town hall meeting, one of the main concerns from everybody was, you know, it's not fair that I have to pay for parking. I mean, I'm, you know, working downtown, I'm employed, I'm being a good citizen by having a job. Why should I have to pay parking? And so I had asked you, was there any way that the city could have looked at it to give them a free parking pass?
In essence, that's kind of the issue we have now. It's too cheap and it's on the curb. And the $30 is really to have kind of a tracking system of the passes. And we feel that it's a dollar a day. Right now, everybody that's parking on the curb, feeding the meter all day, is paying $2 a day. So this is beyond. This is cheaper than the current rate that they pay now. And you know, even if you work 15 days out of the week or 15 days out of the month or 20 days a month, we thought $30 was our initial was $60, $2 a day. But this is just so that the traffic department can kind of keep track of who has a permit, who doesn't have a permit. There are some costs that are associated with that, printing and laminating and doing that stuff. So really, you know, that's what it's going to.
Last time you were here, I had asked you about the parking lot that's by Linear Park that doesn't have meters. Have we made any ground on that? Or is it going to be free parking
everybody? We've been so busy with other things. I've been meaning to email or contact Judge Hanen to see a lot of the people using that parking lot are federal courthouse employees. Mm-hmm. So I will address that, but we've had a lot of other things.
Nothing against them.
So,
Ramiro, can you mention the parking areas that these people would be able to park, the employees that get
the $30?
They're
in the ordinance, and our plan is if this effort does pass, we will provide some informational brochures. We'll make that, the maps and the parking lots. So.
Anything else, Commissioner?
This was noticed in the paper.
No, this is a public hearing. This is the first reading, so we still have public hearing. I would suppose my friend Roberto wishes to address us.
Roberto Uresti. First of all, at that meeting we had, Mr. Gonzalez just mentioned there was an abuse. Well, I don't see any abuse. I think this issue is just to get more revenues for the city to buy more buildings to give them away to UTV. That's about it. Because basically, I cannot see there is no problem. Now, Commissioner Jessica just said something very important. How come they don't put meters around Washington Park, around Piedmont School, around the Cameron County Courthouse? They're across the street, but not on that side. Why don't we extend all the way to the malls and put meters over there? But I cannot see that there is a problem. There is no problem. I asked Mr. Gonzalez here about the $450 maintenance fee, and it's being straight into the general fund instead of being used for what it was for. And it's not being used correctly. This extra money, because Mr. Gonzalez here said that he's gonna generate another $300,000. At 75 cents, we're looking at almost $1 million. Where is that money gonna go to? This is the problem I see. I think a lot of people have the same perception that this money is not gonna be used for the downtown deal. Let's go back many years ago, the Three Amigos. The Three Amigos decided to build peninsulas on Elizabeth Street. And all that money was done wrong. They had to go back and redestroy all of that, supposedly, to bring in. But let's be hard on this. How many businesses are left in the downtown area? Just walk around and they're empty. So I cannot see a problem. The person he mentioned from Washington, D.C., I went to Washington, D.C. All they got there is we'll tow your vehicle away. There is no parking in Washington, D.C. I had to park almost a mile away to go to the Lincoln Memorial. Harlingen doesn't have no meters because somebody called me from Harlingen. He said, man, I'm very happy that you guys have that problem and we don't. Wow, it makes me think. Why is McAllen so good at 75 cents? Because they build garages. If you would guarantee me, Mayor, that this money will go for garages, I'm not gonna fight, because we do need garages downtown. Not one, not two, but three. If you really want to improve the downtown area, you got to have established. And the city of Brownsville has not taken any advantages, especially building bridges. We could have made a lot of money on building bridges into Mexico, but we didn't, never took action until the Veterans Bridge, and we only get 20% or 30% or whatever money we're getting out there. Let's start doing something right for Brownsville, and we're not doing it. My complaint is basically that the money needs to be used for what it's for intended, not to build another palm tree. I don't think that's correct. And to blame the downtown employees, one of those individuals, if you were not there at the meeting, he said something very important. He said some of these people work part-time, and they were gonna charge him $60 for that permit. Now they bring it down to $30 for that permit. Is that correct, Mr. Gonzalez? Okay. So please, all of you, how hard is this system? I don't know how we have to go to other cities and compare their 75, $1, $3. You want to charge them $5? Here, you run everybody. My brother, Ramon Ureste, he told me something very unusual. He said, what are they trying to do? Run the people out of the downtown area? That's what he told me. And I thought about that. And I think my brother's pretty smart, because he always said something, and I'm gonna say it when you have another public hearing, there's something in there, I can't say it here. But please, I know some of you do think about this, that the employees, other people, don't change it, keep it. If you're gonna change it, don't make it increments. It's bad enough that our utility bills go up in increments every year, October, and more increments. Please, you can change it if you want to, just forget it. Just leave it as it is. Thank you.
Leticia Perez Garzoria, and I was at that meeting where Mr. Ureste was there and a whole bunch of other citizens as well. What is the problem? Money? People? Stores? Egos? Stimulation? What is exactly the problem, like Mr. Uresti wants to find out? What is the core of it? We citizens want to know, what is the core of it, and why are we paying? I don't work in downtown Brownsville, but if I did, I would be very concerned. If I'm barely making a part-time job, and I'm barely feeding my family, and bringing two grocery bags to my home, I would be very, very, very disillusioned of, why work at all? Why? I'm in the same hole. I'm not getting anywhere. What is the thinking about increasing these rates? To help who? Whom are we helping? We're not helping the people downtown that have the stores. Go look around town for lease, for lease, for lease, for lease, for lease, for lease. Close, 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 close. What are you doing? What are you doing to us? We like our downtown. I love the downtown. It's not what it used to be, but what the heck? It's our downtown. Now you're going to put a big block on it, a big, big boulder on top of it, and you say, it's not going to grow. We're just going to do these little projects in piecemeals, like Mr. Uresti says. You know what? I don't think there's a plan. I don't think there's a source. I think we're hopscotching through a lot of things, and you're not looking at those people downtown. You're not looking. You're not really caring enough to know what they struggle. I've heard stories and stories. We're barely making it. Tenemos que cerrar. We don't know what we're... People are hurting. I mean, it's nice that we sit here in the commission and things are well, and that's good. But those people out there are not well. And who's voicing any opinions for those people? Nobody. This is why all of these people are here, because nobody is talking. Let's talk about the people. Let's talk about not resources and little gadgets and gimmicks that we see, and not a full report, because Mr. Gonzalez didn't know how to answer what happened in Harlingen. What about their meters? What are you doing? Stifle business. Stifle people. Put them down. Scratch them out. Let's do what we need to do in the name of progress. Por favor, take a second look. Look around you. There's human beings, there's families. There's a lot of hurting people, and I don't see the point in it. If you see it and you skip over it and you turn a blind eye to it, that's not me. But I appreciate you listening to us, and consider it before you drop down the hammer. Thank you so much.
I've got my piece.
Yeah, okay.
Rarely, but sometimes I do agree with my teacher. And I've spoken to you. We haven't had the conversations that you might have had with other members on the board. There's so many things here that need to get addressed. I appreciate the studies. I appreciate the time. But the fact is, our downtown is hurting. There are projects that are being done. This commission has taken a proactive approach towards revitalizing downtown. But let's face it, if I were doing your presentation, I'd have left the 1976 slide up there for at least a minute so it can get clear, so that people can understand. A raise has been a long time coming, but it hasn't gotten done. Eventually, I've been sitting here for 11 years, and I know that there's things that were coming that needed to get done. Okay, we voted to lower taxes 1 year. But then we had to raise the following. The demand is different every year. We haven't had an increase, but yet at this time, we cannot honestly tell the people of the city of Brownsville, we have a downtown that can sustain 75 cents. Because I come downtown for purchases on certain things. Okay? But they're not what is in downtown San Antonio. They're not what's in downtown Houston. It's because it's at a cheaper price. Parking is free at the mall. You know, You go to Sunrise Mall and you park for free. And that's where you're getting all your high-end retail stuff. Let's face it. Ask everybody in this room. I know you're here for something else, but this is something you should be speaking out on, not just two people. For the people that are sitting in here, you should be coming up here and speaking your piece, because you need to be heard, because this will affect you when you come to the downtown area to buy the cheap things that we use for our everyday lives. How many of us don't? I do it. I come by, one of the main things that I come by is my Heats for the cucarachos, because it does work. So I come use that, and I use that all around my house. I come to the Chinitos. My ex-wife comes and buys, you know, all the time. We come to downtown because there's a lot of things that are at a cheaper price that we can get. That's why we come. We as a city, and I'll say this on behalf of previous city commissions, we as a city have tried to revitalize downtown. It's a work in process. Over the last 5 years, we're moving ahead. We're moving at a lot faster pace than we were many years ago. But to come by and say, we're gonna go at 60 cents, we're gonna go by and then increase to 75 cents later on. It's just like Robert said, guarantee me that you're gonna build the multi-level parking. Guaranteed. We have one. We have one that's coming up. Okay, one is gonna go up. But you're right, we do need three. Three is what we need exactly, and that will draw. But yet, your project where you say you want these funds to go doesn't tell me multi-level. Doesn't tell me a multi-level parking. We have a variety of projects that we can choose. But it doesn't say where we can go out for multi-parking. This community is in very much need, and Mr. Cavalier and I have had this conversation over the last at least 5-6 years. This community is in desperate need of going down for a bond election. But that bond election needs to be prepared correct, and the citizens need to be told exactly what that money is going to be used for. Now, my proposal, when it comes time after we close, I guess we'll close public hearing and then I can take a stab at it or whatever the wishes of the commission is.
I think if everybody's through commenting, we will entertain a motion to
close public hearing.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
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 Motion carries.
Mayor, I'm going to make a motion that we go to 50 cents, not give it a time limit as far as it's going to be permanent, but yet in the future, still willing to work with you to go to 50 cents, not say 3 years, but just say as the commission, whatever commission is sitting, might see fit to go to an increase, be it that it merits it. But that we go to 50 cents, I am in agreement with helping out people at $30 a month. That I will not argue, but my motion must also say that it's not gonna go into a personal fund, the money is gonna stay in the general fund. That's my motion.
What was the fund was supposed to be for the in the general fund or not?
No.
It's going to go into the downtown revitalization?
Yeah.
So you're...
My motion is for it to go at 50 cents an hour, for it to go at $30 for a parking permit for employees downtown, and that the money remain in the general fund.
I have a question. Ramiro, you did mention, I believe, that the fund would be developed to be overseen, or rather the projects that would come out of that fund would be decided on in large part by actual merchants and people who have vested interests downtown.
Yeah, the idea, we visited with legal, and because this ordinance is dealing with parking meters, we didn't want to, it kind of opened up some doors that we didn't want to. What we thought about is we'll bring this ordinance before you, and then we'll bring either a resolution or something else that establishes that that committee that will oversee these funds. And the idea is to have downtown stakeholders, landowners, business owners, people that are interested in downtown. I want to work with legal on the makeup of that committee and how that would look. But that is the idea, that once this downtown fund is created, if it is approved, then there would be a committee that would look at how this money is best dispersed or spent.
And I do like that portion of the ordinance, because people that are using the parking are investing in downtown, and will be that funding will be decided not by the general fund, but by people, merchants, property owners, people that have a vested interest in downtown. And that's part of the ordinance that I liked very much.
So just as a clarification, the creation of the fund is in the ordinance. The creation of the committee is not, because we didn't want to put it in this ordinance, but we will work to bring it.
I understand.
In front of us.
We already have a what we call a motor vehicle parking system fund. And all the monies from the parking meters and the people that pay for overparking goes into that fund already. Collections are being done by municipal court. Municipal court is being funded by the general fund. We are currently, like he mentioned earlier, we're apparently just subsidizing still the parking meter fund, because the parking meter fund is not generating enough revenues to pay for the employees that are being paid out of the parking meter fund. But we already have what we call a motor vehicle parking system fund.
So Pete, would I be correct? I'm trying to get to a consensus here. If it goes to the general fund, is it basically, if you go up to 50 cents, would you be possibly just being cutting out even, and you're still not getting any money into the downtown revitalization? Would that be where you're going to be at? I mean, in all reality, what I'm saying to you is, let's get to a real solution here. And I think people are trying to get to all the people that are interested in this issue, but it seems to me that at the raise of from 25 to 50 cents under the possible rate that we got now, we're arguing about no money that's going to the revitalization anyway. Is that right?
There will be some, but not that much, Mayor, based on 25 cents.
Okay. Do you have any suggestion, Pete, as to how, in other words, if you have any overage after you get that fund, whatever overage is there, could that be funneled into more directed towards the downtown?
The motor vehicle fund currently is about $300,000, $310,000. That's how much we make off just meters, not tickets, just meters. And usually it's about $10,000 or $20,000 that subsidizes that motor vehicle fund that Mr. Gonzalez is discussing. What the ordinance states is that any revenue above $350,000,
okay,
goes into a downtown revitalization fund. I believe what Mr. Longoria is saying, the elimination of the revitalization fund, and it'll strictly mean that the revenue to the motor vehicle fund will increase by whatever amount it increases with a 50 cent increase under his motion. Am I correct? That's.
We can certainly use any funds, any so we call it surplus funds, or the motor vehicle parking system fund, once this increase goes in, and that money can be used for the downtown revitalization.
But it's not guaranteed to be used for downtown, as you said.
We make it a point.
Unless we change it.
Yes. Yes, ma'am.
But by the same token, he can come request.
I'm sorry?
In other words, okay, it will not go into a downtown revitalization, but if there's a project, if there's a viable project that's coming, planning department can come and say, this is what we're looking at and we're looking for funding, and it can come from the source.
Yes.
But it just won't be in that one account.
Right. In other words, there's no money going out of that fund for general fund. General fund kicks in money into that fund to keep it above ground. We also are not charging for the collections that municipal court has for the overparking. That's municipal court is strictly paid out of the general fund. So there's a small amount there that.
I think the answer comes somewhere in this area. It would appear to me that once it's paid off, in other words, it's a self-sustaining system, and once you have any overages, that amount can be in the general fund, but I think maybe the option would be that if planning has any
projects
that they would wish that they would have first priority. Would that, it seems like that would accomplish that particular, objective. I'm not sure.
I'd be willing to amend to that.
The only difference is that the downtown merchants don't have an equal voice unless they speak to the commissioners who happen to sit on the commission at that
time.
Well,
I don't think anybody should oppose a committee being formed through whatever source that they have, so that they have an advisory type of role, and I think it can work its way through. At least we can try it for a while so that we can get all of our goals accomplished. That would be my thinking. Does anybody have any suggestions to offer? Okay, now, so let's make sure that we know what our motion is. It's basically an increase to 50 cents. You still have your 30-day pass. You have it going to the
Motor Transportation
Fund, and should there be an excess of what it is required to come out even for sustaining that particular system, then the planning department would be advised and then prioritize downtown. If they're good projects, that it would be prioritized for downtown revitalization efforts.
Correct.
Is that a fair motion? Is that somebody?
I just have one other comment, and it's related but not exactly the same thing. I shop downtown, and I want everyone to hear this, not because it's cheap, but because there are things downtown that I can't find anywhere else, and I thank you, the merchants, for providing those things downtown.
Okay. So will somebody adopt my motion? So moved by Commissioner, second by Mr. Villarreal. All those in favor say aye.
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 Any nays? Motion carries. Thank you. Thank you, everybody, for all their input. Appreciate it.
Item 10, public hearing and action on first reading of ordinance number 235-2013-057-S to allow a restaurant and a party place in a general retail H classification and a dwelling A classification for 3.28 acres out of Lot 7, Block Double D of Brownsville Land and Improvement Company subdivision located at 1904 Central Boulevard.
Mayor, City Commission, this was a case that was before P&Z last month. It had some opposition. There was a letter that was signed by a lot of neighbors in the area. We do have a process to where it is protested, and this qualifies as a protested case, but it was not noticed correctly. As you can see, normally when it's the protested case, we notice, and it said protested ordinance number. So we are going to request that you table this item until the next meeting, so that we can notice
item,
it correctly.
Item number 10.
Move to table. Second.
All those in favor say aye.
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 Any nays? Motion carries.
Item 11, public hearing in action on first reading of ordinance number 235-2014-007-S to allow apartments in a apartment G classification and a dwelling Z classification for lot 4, tract I of 5.79 acres and lot 4 and 7, tract 3 for 9.5 acres of Las Lagunas located near Paredes Line Road and Alton Glor Boulevard.
Mayor, City Commission, this is a development that's calling for about 200 apartments, high-end apartments. As this is Alton Glor right here, or El Jardín Heights, and this is Tony Road. This is Paredes, and this is Tony's Road. There's a Denny's here and a couple of other businesses on this side. The P&Z Commission looked at this site. They unanimously approved that this case be approved before you. There was one person that came in to not oppose. She didn't oppose, but there was a little bit of a title issue, some sort of title issue with the property that she wanted to address before the Planning and Zoning Commission. So P&Z recommends, planning recommends that you approve this case.
Ramiro, the only question I have is that I know I've traveled that road and you're seeing for 200, is it 200
yes,
apartments?
Ma'am.
And that road is kind of small.
Yes, we've worked with them on that, with the owners. They are going to give us additional right of way, and we're working on trying to accommodate or trying to work something out to where they can improve the road as well.
It'll be at their expense that they're going to be expanding the road?
Some expansion and some repaving and some improvements to the road.
But it'll be at their expense?
Yes. What they're trying to do is they're trying to get with all the other property owners so that they can form a group that they could pay for the improvement of this street.
But you do realize, do they realize, is the applicant here?
Yes, they are.
Okay. 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 Does the applicant realize that it's not just a road? It's also utilities. It's also infrastructure that goes into the road. And I'll be honest with you, it's a viable project. If you were to ask me, it's something that's much needed in the city. But when you start, you know, Commissioner brings up a very good point. We have put a lot of thousands, hundreds of thousands, close to maybe a million, in roads where the school district has built their schools. And we've had to go in and put in streets. We've had to go and put in infrastructure. And I don't know if the person that's building this has taken into consideration the amount of money that is needed to be able to put the proper infrastructure to have a good road in when building these kinds of projects.
I'm sure they're very aware of the cost of development. You're right. I mean, every development requires water and sewer and everything else. So I'm sure they've researched that. We really didn't get into that because this is a zoning case. But we did discuss the specific use is that they do improvements to that road on their cost. So what they're now trying to do, I believe, is meet with all these owners and try to see if they can come together and together improve the road.
Yeah, but so, what are the chances that the other owners are going to want to put money into something that's not going to benefit them?
The specific use does say that they have to have improvements to the road. So
and you're using the complete streets model for that road.
Well, I mean, that's a different process. That's the
Asking, because if we're going to approve this, then we have to take into consideration, are they going to update that street to the standards that we have set for ourselves with other streets?
Exactly. I mean, it'd have to come up to city standards, the standards that are in the ordinance. And there's right now there's currently 40 feet. I think they're willing to give another 10 feet. The standard street in the city is 50 feet, 50 foot of right-of-way. That's what we require. So that they have been willing to come forward with that. So they're working on trying to get those improvements done into their project costs. So, but I mean, this is the only thing before you tonight is the zoning case and approving the zoning there. So it's a public hearing.
Yeah. Any other comments?
Ma'am? No.
I.
You're not alone.
I think both of you are.
We are.
Your name?
Deborah Canales. Thank you for hearing me out. We're four homes.
I believe it's right here, no? One of these properties.
Yes. Now, there's a Resaca that is right there also, which is not there. Road has been.
There you go. This is the Resaca. I think that's your house, right?
Right. The road has been built, maybe it was maybe 3-4 months ago. So it's a brand new road where it's a quiet neighborhood. Like he said, that's my home right there. We just bought the acres, and the acres that are right next to my home are being sold as well. I don't think they're being told that there's going to be an apartment complex built, because if not, they will not buy the home. But like we said, it's a quiet neighborhood. We have kids. The last thing we need is a traffic property. I'm sure it's going to change the value of it. So I strongly oppose. My husband's not here today, right now, but Ms. Ramirez and her mom is here, so I don't know if you want to hear them out too. But
no, I want to. It's public hearing. Everybody's entitled to be heard.
Okay. So I strongly oppose.
You strongly oppose it.
Yes,
thank
sir.
You very much.
Good evening. My name is Guadalupe Trevino, and to a certain extent, we don't oppose to the apartments. What I'm opposing, or we oppose, is that they don't touch 1 acre which is belongs to my mom till the day she dies, okay? After that, okay. But in widening the road, they're gonna go right by the front door of my mom's house, which is right in front of Canales' house, right where the little curve is. So if they widen the road without, now, if they're willing to talk to my mom, excuse the expression, but we're willing to wheel and deal.
Yes, ma'am.
But.
I gotta,
tell us like it is.
But they're not gonna widen it in front, and we don't want them to touch the 1 acre that belongs to her. And that is in their way.
And I got a feeling your mother can really wheel and deal, okay?
Right there by Debbie. Yeah. So again, like I say.
You know, Ramiro, is there any way that, you know, in other words, it looks like they're counting on having the rest of the neighborhood go along with them, and where they don't really have any assurances or any, like, memorandums of understanding as to who's going to allow them to do that. And I think unless you have that sort of assurance in writing, from a legal standpoint, it's going to be a standstill no matter what. Because the wheeler and dealer right there, she's gonna wheel and deal.
Yeah.
So I don't know. It might be a good
A
good one to maybe table and say, listen, go get yourself some understanding of what your neighbors want to do before you come back to us, and that way we know that it's gonna happen or it's not gonna happen. Because first of all, it's an expensive proposition to begin with. I know that. And second of all, in all of our good faith, sometimes we go to the neighbors and they're going like, you know, sorry, Charlie. And so what are you going to do? You know, and now you have a different, you know, ordinance changing the zoning. And for what reason? So.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I would entertain a motion to table.
Move to table.
Second.
Go ahead. Ms. Canales, before you think I'm a nice guy, I'm usually for these kinds of projects. But what I am going to ask you, I know that it'll be very difficult to change your mind, because I do understand Tony Flores is a very good friend of mine who also lives out there, and I'm not very big on telling people what they can do with their investments and what they can do with their properties. As an elected, and I'm speaking for myself, as an elected official, I can't sit up here and tell somebody, you know, taking their hard-earned money and wanting to make an investment. You know, if they've purchased the property, if they fall within our guidelines that the city is structured under, you know, they have a right to do it. Of course, you have the right to come and oppose, but ultimately it'll be this body that makes the decision. But in doing so, I would expect that these people, you know, come out and give us something a little bit more concrete, Ramiro. We do need something a little bit more concrete.
No, I just think you're going into an exercise in futility if, in fact, you're anticipating someone's going to go ahead and do something and they don't do it, and you've changed the zoning, then where did you go?
This is a specific use. So the specific use only has what we do is we put a year timeline on this. So if they can't get the project underway in a year, then they have to come back before you and get it approved or get it, you know, amended or whatever.
Well, I'm just saying that it just seems like good planning to get all your ducks lined up in an order in a row and then come up here and say, you know, hey, I got everything ready to go. I mean, I don't know. Time is money for most of us.
If there's a new road that's gone in, you know, we're going to expect that if they're going to be picking up the rest, that they build to our standard.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
You know,
I think that somebody did adopt a motion to table.
And I seconded it.
Okay. All those in favor say, I'm sorry.
Oh, we didn't close public hearing.
Oh, close public hearing.
There's still people that want to speak.
I'm sorry.
I'll retract my second. And then there's the applicants.
Hi, good afternoon. My name is Carlos Garcia. I'm here representing GR Developments. One of the issues that we have here is obviously the width of the street to satisfy the needs of the apartment complex and the needs of the owners who have houses there. The land around our development, our planned development, is. Do you have a pointer, someone? Here. The owner of this land is the FAR Limited, and they're also the owners here on these lots. Is that me or is that? Okay.
It's right there on the 235.
I think somebody put down the...
The 235, yeah. It's just, they're giving you more space to work with.
Okay. These lots here are also by the same owner. We've spoken with the owner of this land, and he's willing to help us out in regards to the cost of the street widening. The owner here is Julio Gonzalez. We spoke with him as well, and he's all for that because he's also has got plans to develop commercial space in this area soon. The owner here is IBC, and IBC is actually financing our project, and they're in the best disposition to work something out with us. This land here, a church just bought this land from Julio Gonzalez. So what Ms. Canales was saying right now about having a lot of traffic here, I hate to let you know, but you're already going to have a lot of traffic with us or not us with the church that's going to be built here very soon. So all this is going to be developing pretty soon now. What we're trying to do is we're trying to satisfy and cumplir, how do you say?
Satisfy?
No, not. Meet the requirements.
Meet the requirements of the city, and we've done that. We had the right of way at 40. We're going up to 50 to meet the requirements of the cities. We're also, in regards to the investment that has to be done in the streets, we understand that there might be owners like Ms. Canales that would like to live in a neighborhood with few circulation of cars and few noise. This is going to be a gated community. It is a big apartment complex, which we believe Brownsville needs right now, something of this quality. There's not going to be a lot of cars in and out, just owners, because only the owners of the property will be able to go in and go out. In regards to Ms. Ramirez, we could reassure you that we will work something out with her. We could even put you up in an apartment or relocate you in another place. Like we said, the owner of the land at our development is also the owner of the land right across the street. So if she would like to stay there, I'm sure we could work something out with the owner of the land just to put her up right across the street from where she is. But that's something we could speak to in the near future.
I think she wants to talk. That's a good girl.
With Ms. Canales.
I like her.
With Ms. Canales, I understand what you're trying to say. We actually live close to the Coffeeport Road that's behind HEB and IBC and that really nice neighborhood. That's a very narrow road, and you got a lot of traffic there. You got the Sun Colony Apartments, you got HEB, you got IBC, you got the CVS. I could guarantee you that we're not going to have as much traffic as that street is going to have, as that street has right there in Coffeeport Road than in Tony's Road, to tell you the truth. And because I go often to that IBC, that's our bank that helps us out with our developments, and that's the HEB I go to. It's not that much traffic, and that is a high concentrated crossway in Paredes and Coffeeport and Ruben Torres. So it's just my word, but I could reassure you, Ms. Canales, that it's not as bad as how it might seem as the size of the apartment complex. Our mission here with this apartment complex development is really giving the city of Brownsville something it needs. I mean, all we hear, I was born and raised in Brownsville. This is a Brownsville company. We're sick and tired of all these nice developments going to other places in the Rio Grande Valley. I think Brownsville has the potential
and,
of...
And I don't think any one of us disagrees here. This is not that. You just have a young lady right there that looks like she's ready to come to the pay window with you. And that's what I'm saying is maybe if you had that particular issue worked out and maybe if you could assure anyone else that's here of, you know, I mean, I'm pretty familiar with that area, and
yes.
I'm familiar with good developments, and I truly would like to have good developments, but I also like to honor someone like Mom there, because
I think with all due respect, I think she's the person here, the lady here, that we have least problems with. Well, I mean, it seems.
I know. That's what I'm saying. Go visit.
So what I'm saying here is that if this is an issue of specific use and having the land being approved as a multifamily and us complying with the city requirements, I don't see that we've done anything we shouldn't or that we're not complying to. Maybe we're not complying to Ms. Canales is what she wants, and I respect that, but. This is going to be beneficial for all the owners around that area.
Hermano, in my time here,
yes,
I've seen beautiful projects come and go,
okay,
and get denied over simple little compliance things. Okay, you've got a beautiful project. You stand in a very good place, or the people that you represent stand in a very good place at getting approved. All we're asking you mm-hmm. is to go back and take care of some loose ends. Give us some guarantees on what the road's going to be. You've got 75% of the people. Julio Gonzalez is a very dear friend of mine. Okay? You've got 75, from what it looks like, you've got 75% of the people willing to work with you. That's some good odds. If you only have to take care of 25% of the 75% you got there, it sounds like a winner to me. You're in a good situation. I would work on that 25% just to make sure that all my I's are dotted and all my T's are crossed.
Okay.
And make sure that you have a viable project because, you know, stranger things have happened. Okay.
I appreciate that. But that 25% that we have to figure out, we have to resolve, is that about the street or about what?
Well, you have the street compliance to deal with us.
Right.
In other words, you have to comply with our streets.
Yes.
As per your agreement.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. But what I'm saying is, you've got some issues there that you're going to have to deal with. That's in other words, my advice in good faith is that, you know, you all tend to this. The neighbors. Yeah, with the
Can
neighbors.
Can you be a little bit more?
No, if I understood correctly, yeah, just a second. I think her property is in question, isn't it, in order for you to comply with our requirements?
The acre that she's talking about with her mom?
Yes.
So
yes.
That's what I'm saying. If you could, and again, I don't mean to cut a public hearing short, and I'm not trying to delay anything.
That's fine.
But we will be here all night long, guys. So if.
But I think if we should be speaking with somebody as Ms. Canales, not Ms. Ramirez.
Well,
Ms. Ramirez, sorry.
I think planning will explain to you what the concerns are, because we're here to look at if it's going to cost us down the road. And that was my main concern, that with regards to the expansion of this, the road and stuff.
I agree with you. I mean, I can't say how many times planning department really kind of comes together and brings people together and brings you a solid case. So I mean, you know, the motion is on the table, right? I think motion.
Well, there's a motion to table.
Still, yeah. Is there a second? So we promise to do that. We'll kind of
a real quick comment. I mean, I think that's really cool that. Something of this magnitude is coming to Brownsville. And
I'm sorry, we have one more gentleman over here.
Can I finish?
Go ahead, I'm sorry.
Okay. I just wanted to let them know that I am very impressed that something of this magnitude is, you know, that you're willing to build here in Brownsville, because it's true, I see a lot of development in other cities, McAllen, whatnot, and so I just wanted to say that I appreciate the fact that you want to build in Brownsville.
Yes, sir. Commissioner Scott, thank you all for, I wasn't here for this, but my daughter just mentioned to me, my name is Chayo Leal. I'm not a resident of Brownsville. I was born and raised here. I pay a lot of taxes. I have real estate properties here and everything. I live in El Jardin Heights Road, which is now Hugh Emerson Road. You all need to do a correction for all this road. Everybody calls El Jardín Heights Hugh Emerson Road, which I think that's the legal name now. It was formerly El Jardín Heights. It's also FM 3248. It's not Alton Glow Road, so you need to correct that. Now, I live further on down on Cavazos Road and Camino de la Tierra. A few years ago, Commissioner Longoria, I was here about 10 years ago. We grouped about 200 people. The city was trying to annex us. At that time, it was not to our advantage. Mr. Julio Gonzalez was on our side. That's about the time that the sports park was going to get built at that area. They were trying to buy it from Mr. Murphy. That went sour. We were not annexed, thanks to God. We're country people. We live out there. I know Ms. Ramirez. Tony's Road was built by the county. Okay, that was built a few months ago by Commissioner Hernandez. I don't know if you all know, but that's still county property. I know that there's an extraterritorial jurisdiction. The county has the city has a say-so on what happens there. All I'm telling you, if you will table it, please, I will get some opposition to this because there are a lot of us that own acreage. I myself own 7 acres there, and we will oppose it. We will get 200 people to oppose this project because as it is right now, Mr. Gonzalez has given in part of the property. There's going to be a church built there, but there's a lot of people in Barcelona. We're all precinct 2 in Cameron County. I'm just serving notice that if you will table it, I will get a petition going and my neighbors to oppose this project.
You are up for a review for annexation.
I know that.
I'm kidding.
I know that, but we'll do it again. When you annex Cameron Park, you can come and get me. But as it is right now, we're fine and dandy with the county. But that's a separate. I know they did, but that's a separate issue. But I'm not for or against the gentleman that wants to build this thing. But we need to be served notice because we live within that area.
Yeah, but it, you don't live within the radius that needs to be notified.
What is the radius?
It's a 500-foot radius.
How much?
The 500-foot.
Tony does.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's a 200-foot
radius. Thank you very much.
That's what you were
noting. Okay, guys.
Otherwise, table.
Second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Okay. Motion tabled. Okay. Number 12.
Item 12, public hearing in action on first reading of ordinance number 235-2014-003 to rezone from professional office G to light retail G classification for lot 1, block 1 of the Gavada subdivision, located at 455 East Los Ebanos Boulevard.
Can you read the next?
The next one?
Yeah.
Item 13, public hearing in action on first reading of ordinance number 235-2014-003-S to allow a medium commercial G classification in the light retail G for lot 1, block 1 of the Gavada subdivision located at 455 East Los Ebanos Boulevard.
And also 14, they're all the same case.
Okay. Item 14, public hearing in action on first reading of ordinance number 235-2014-601-CU to allow a conditional use permit to sell and consume on-premises alcohol for 0.59 acres of lot 1, block 1 of the Gavada subdivision located at 455 East Los Ebanos Boulevard.
Good evening, Mayor, Commissioners. This is a specific use for a party place, and at the same time is for the consuming alcohol and selling the alcohol. This is along the Los Ebanos and Russell Road. This is very close to Central Boulevard. This was before the Planning and Zoning Commission, all in favor, and there were no opposition to the case from the neighbors.
We have somebody that wants to say something.
Public hearing.
Public comment.
Roberto Ureste. I just have one thing. I think every time it seems like Brownsville lives on selling liquor, basically. The only way Brownsville can make any money is beer and liquor. And if you go to my district, the stripes that's there on 802 and military, you should see how much beer they sell every day. The money you guys get from the sales tax. My brother, again, Ramon Ureste, told me one thing, and he said, always say it finally. In the Great Depression, the only businesses that didn't go out of business was beer joints and stores that sold food. Brownsville continues. It seems like they all get approved to sell liquor. If we ask every store, even Walmart starts selling liquor, you would approve it. sometimes we have to stop thinking about all this liquor. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. I'll entertain a motion to close public hearing.
Move to close.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Anybody opposed? Okay. Action item?
Anybody? Can I make a point of discussion? Just real
sure.
quick. On the party place, they want a permit to sell liquor there? They're yes. going to have a party place, but they're asking for permission to sell liquor?
Yes.
Okay. I can tell you from experience from somebody that works at these places, that doesn't work. They're going to try it, and they're going to stop within a year because it really doesn't work. If you're not a BYOB place, if you're a party place and I can't bring in my own stuff, you're going to sell it to me? It's not going to work. I can tell you that because I work in these types of places every weekend. And it doesn't work for them. They end up giving it up within a year.
Okay.
If it's any consolation.
Okay. How about?
Move to approve.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any nays? Motion carries.
Item 15, public hearing in action on first reading of ordinance number 235-2014-001-S to allow apartments in a general retail G classification for abstract 2 Valadez Reserve at 4.36 acres located at 4865 Paredes Line Road.
Again, we have another map, another case of apartments. Very close to the previous one. This is on Paredes. And south of the middle school. This was also before the Planning and Zoning Commission. All
what
in
middle
favor.
School is it?
I'm sorry?
What middle school is it?
Vela. Vela Middle School. It's right here. And again, the Planning and Zoning Commission, all in favor of the specific use.
Public comment.
Okay, any comments? If not, I'll
move to close.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Motion carries.
Move to approve.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Motion carries. Thank you, sir.
Item 16, public hearing in action on first reading of ordinance number 235-2014-005 to rezone from dwelling G classification to general retail G for lot 1, block 1 of Texas Meat Subdivision located at 1395 Highway 281.
Again, another map, and this is for retail, for commercial G. This is along the 802 and 281. As you can see, everything's around this property is already 4C. So this is to rezone from dwelling because the grocery store has been there for a while, and now they ask it to change it to a commercial.
Public comment.
And close.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Motion carries.
Move to approve.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Motion carries.
Thank you.
Public comment period. understanding and agreement between the City of Brownsville and the Texas Historical Commission for the Stegman Building.
Mayor, City Commission, as you know, we've been working on the Stegman Building. This is an agreement that has to be in place between the City of Brownsville and the Historic Commission. We did create, there was a historical study done. It will be a significant impact, but this is a way to remediate it. And we ask for your approval today. I think the remediation is not much. We just have to document what is currently at the building. So we're already underway. We're pushing forward. We just need this to be signed.
Would approve. Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Motion carries.
Item 19, consideration in action on resolution number 2014-035 to designate the Montezuma Cypress Tree as the official city tree. Do you want me to read the other one too? Both of them?
Sure, why not?
And item 20, consideration and action on resolution number 2014-036 to designate the Sable Palm as the official city palm.
Mayor, City Commission, we've been, Gene and I and a lot of people have been working on this Montezuma Cypress project. We just wanted to show you a couple of pictures and a couple of some history just really quick. This is the bald cypress is not quite the Montezuma Cypress, but you could kind of picture that this is what Browns will look like along the river and along the Resacas before these trees were cut down because of their wood. So this is actually in Brownsville. This is at the Cypress Preserve, which we call, it's in Southmost at La Posada. And this is a map of the furthest of what exists about the Montezuma Cypress. As you can tell over here, just where the furthest this tree goes. So this is a very special tree to us. This is what these trees look like, and if some of you have been out there, I know some of you haven't. I'll take you out there. It's quite fantastic. This is along the river. These were all provided by Gene. This presentation, you could tell there's remnants of a bridge and a railroad that was built with these trees, going out to Boca Chica Beach and the island. And this is a remnant of what happened, right? People cut down trees and they use it to build bridges and homes and furniture and everything else. This is at the Nature Conservancy site. There's some other cypress trees there. And you can see here that this is the bridge that was built out to the mouth of the river. And this is these are there today. I have not seen these, but these are there today. And these were some of the locations throughout Brownsville. These trees are over 150, 200 years old. This is actually at the old Lincoln Park. This actually grows over the expressway. If you're driving on the expressway, you can see this grow over. This is the real famous one where Amazonia used to be on Central. I believe Mr. Morris Clint, who is here, planted
he could probably
that tree.
Give you the whole history.
And this is, so these are trees just throughout Brownsville that you can see. Over the past 2 months, I have to give Gene all the credit. He's rallied Eagle Scouts and volunteers to pull out about 600 seedlings that look like that. So he's got an effort underway to replant along the Resaca banks these seedlings once they start surviving. So this is a little baby Montezuma Cypress that you're looking at. And this is City of Planning, Eva and Mr. Clint and Gene. I think they discussed it, the history of the cypress. The second one, so these two resolutions are to adopt an official city tree and official city palm. We work with the beautification committee. You know, we said, well, the palm is not a tree, you know, and you go back and forth. So what's before you here is to designate the cypress tree as the official city tree and the sable as the official city palm. So we're very excited about this project, and I think Gene can provide more details if you want, or we can take you out there if you ever want.
Sure, I've been out there. So do I have a motion?
Motion to approve. Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Motion carries. Number 20.
Number 20.
We have one more. That was 19. How about number 20 for the sable palm?
You didn't have to action.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Motion carries.
Yay. Item.
Gene, thank you.
I was watching.
Item 21, Brownsville Historical Association recognition of Mr. Morris Clint for lifetime botanical and horticultural service to the city of Brownsville.
Why don't you guys come up with him, okay? And Amanda? This is a family deal.
Mayor, commissioners, this is indeed an honor in order to recognize this wonderful man who is the Johnny Appleseed of the cypress trees for Brownsville. Did you see the one at the Amazonia? Did you see the one, you know, various big ones and whatever? Mr. Clint left this part of the country as a young man with a dream in order to go into horticulture. And he had no idea the impact that he was going to do on Brownsville. That tree at Amazonia was planted in 56, thereabouts. Now, this tree will grow to be 1,000 years old, as well as the rest of them. So can you imagine somebody going into horticulture and botany and giving such an impact upon the city? Well, that's what this is all about. This is recognition by the Brownsville Historical Association for Lifetime Service Award to Morris Clint for dedication to horticulture interests of the community of Brownsville, Texas, Brownsville Historical Association. A good woman, and this is Amanda's wife. Now, you're going to hang around for the 1,000 years to see. This is guaranteed.
I want it in writing.
You got it.
Mr. Clint, all right. Ms. Clint, thank you so much on behalf of the city. I know that every one of these commissioners would, you know, can't thank you enough. I happen to know they're dear friends of mine, along with their daughter, and so thank you so much. And Jane, thank you for doing this as well. Keep planting, okay?
Amanda, can you carry the tradition?
Mr. Mayor? He's coming around.
Where are we going to plant it?
Gene, I have one more question for both of you. Will there be protection that no one's allowed to cut them down any longer?
Yeah, because I got a 50 caliber machine gun. Yeah.
No, I'm serious, though. Will there be an ordinance that will protect them?
Is there an ordinance on the books, is there not?
Well, I mean, I think we have, this is just kind of like a thing we have to do, and then we'll come back and try to.
Okay, yes. Good.
So. But as I recall, there is an ordinance in place that if a large tree is in the city limits of Brownsville,
yes. Well, that's true.
You cannot touch that's that. That's
true. I have one that has destroyed my driveway.
All right, thank you.
Cool. That's cool.
Planted at Lola's.
Item 22, consideration in action to authorize and execute an interlocal agreement between the Rio Grande Valley Communications Group and the City of Brownsville regarding the 700-800 megahertz trunked radio system.
Mayor, City Commission, requesting the Commission's authority to enter into an interlocal agreement with the Rio Grande Valley Communications Group. Brownsville, City of Brownsville, all valley cities are going into the 800 system, full digital system, and the Rio Grande Valley Communications Group will be managing that system. as in it makes it seamless to where I can talk in McAllen and eventually we'll be talking in Austin. Our own, we have represented on this group by our assistant city manager, Jeff Johnston, and we're requesting your approval on this interlocal agreement.
Move to approve. Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Item 23, consideration and action to authorize Mr. Charlie Kavler, city manager, to accept the Security State Administrative Agency Award from Local Border Security Program fiscal year 2014 from Texas Department of Public Safety, Texas Homeland Security State Administrative Agency in the amount of $126,500.
Mayor, City Commission, this is a Border Star grant. We've been 5 years with Border Star. This funds police officers at the bus station, on the bridge, and also in violent crime investigations. It covers all overtime costs and actually helps us out on our overtime budget. We're requesting approval on this.
Move to approve.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Motion carries.
Thank you.
Item 24, consideration and action to request authorization to renew a term contract for the purchase and delivery of uniforms for the B Metro Department.
Good evening, Mayor and City Commissioners. The City of Brownsville and Brownsville Metro is exercising its unilateral option to extend the term of the uniform contract with Lynx Uniforms of Brownsville for the second 12-month extension of the original quoted price. This is the second of 4 1-year term extensions for this contract. This contract shall expire on March 31st, 2015.
Move to approve.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Motion carries. Thank you, Norma.
Thank
See you. You at the next Ciclovia, okay?
Yep.
Item 25, consideration and action to award a contract for asbestos abatement at the Youth Homeless Resource Center.
Mayor, Commissioners, I'm here to request your support and approval to award a contract for asbestos abatement at the Youth Homeless Resource Center, which is the former mother of Perpetual Help. The contractor is obligated to commence work immediately after receiving the notice to proceed and will complete the abatement work within 30 consecutive calendar days. We went through the whole purchasing process. There were three bidders. The lowest bidder was RL Abatement Incorporated out of Wessico. And once we're done with the 30 days, we can start to get this place going. It'll be a phased project.
Would approve.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Motion carries.
Thank you.
Item 26, consideration and action to award a contract to purchase and deliver 23 rugged laptops for the Brownsville Police Department.
Mayor, City Commission, the last few city commissions, you've authorized us to purchase 23 patrol cars. This is just one of the components. This is a Panasonic toughbook that goes inside the unit. We're requesting approval. $108,000 federal forfeiture funds is covering the cost.
Would approve.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Motion carries.
Thank you.
Item 27, consideration and action to request authorization to renew term contract for purchase and delivery of reflective sheeting for the Brownsville Traffic Department.
Good evening, Mayor and Commissioners. Tonight I'm here to extend the contract from the 3M traffic sheeting reflective signs. I recommend approval.
Motion to approve.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Motion carries.
Thank you.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Motion carries. Thank you, everybody.